And then for our townhome, I'm assuming everyone else is a townhome. Okay, thank you so much. That helps just put it into perspective a little bit. So glad you're joining us. Our next slide. Technology is wonderful until it's not. Hello, welcome. Okay, so these were many of the topics that came up from the questions. There is, a lot of questions about community, camp, you'll notice that camp is up there, budget, pain, affordable. So these are all of the things that we'll be talking about. And so on the next slide is our agenda. Thanks. We'll be starting with our governing structure. We'll talk about budget, reserves, the camp fee, considerations, and then the Q&A. Why are we starting with the governing structure? I think it's always a good place to start. We are a unique community in the fact that typically the state of California doesn't lease land to homeowners or state land, frequently it's not. So it's good to walk through just kind of a little bit about who we are and where we are right now and where we think we'd like to head with your input. Because here's what we've heard. The governing structure was created in 2002. Is it still viable? Does it make sense to still be the same way it is? So let's go back in history just a little bit before we go forward. So looking back, the site authority itself is an interesting name, but the board of the site authority was truly created for the development of this site. As you know, this is a former mental hospital, and it was given over to the state of California, to the California State University Board of Trustees, who basically manage the land here. So that board that we put together was responsible for developing this. And so there's site authority staff, that is John Lasseter. Lazarus, Christina Solis, Salas, excuse me, who's unable to be here, she's in Jamaica. That'd probably be a wonderful place to be tonight. And then myself, who has some oversight for that. So our responsibility with respect to the site authority is to govern the ground sublease, the document that you all sign to lease the ground on which your home, your town home is built. So of course, we look at the maximum resale price to help you with that. We manage the contract with a third party property management company, in this case, Kennedy Wilson. So talking about our property management company, we engage with Kennedy Wilson Properties. And the scope of work is just as it's up here. I won't read this whole thing. I think you're probably pretty familiar with all of the things that our property manager is responsible for. It includes all of those things. Going to the next one. So let's talk about where we are right now, this current governance structure. Within the ground sublease, we have a homeowners advisory council. Well, that was started in 2002. And that's pretty much in the ground sublease that we've all read it and said. This group of volunteers coming from the community is responsible for architectural review, improvements to homes, things like that, and to approve it, and really focusing on that. Well, as we grew, as we aged, we recognized that there needed to be a little bit more than just an architectural review. And in 2015, the site authority chair created what would be considered a subgroup called the CAD, or the Community Advisory Group. And the idea for that was to bring voices to the table. So this includes not only two members of the HAC, but of course representation from Kennedy Wilson, who purchased, you know, the apartments and the town center physical buildings, as well as E&S Ring, who manages our apartments. And then in 2019, because budget is a critical function of what we do, it was decided to create a subgroup called the BAG, or the Budget Advisory Group. We do like our acronyms, we are higher education. And that group is really brought together as representation from the community, from that HAC members, from, again, representation from Kennedy Wilson, the site authority. And the idea behind that is that they will bring together components of the budget that our property management is responsible for pulling those numbers, and then preparing that for the board. So let's just look, and again, going back, and I'm gonna stop for a moment. Please feel free to come on in, find a seat. We've got, of course, always seats right up in the front. So it's like school. So just going back, because it's good to review again. We've been an entity for 22 years now, starting in 2002. So starting in 2002 to current, as I mentioned, we are responsible for the home sales and operations. The site authority financial reporting oversight, in the beginning, as I mentioned, this is land that is owned by the Board of Trustees for the California State University. That was all managed through 2010 by the CSU Chancellor's Office. In 2011, to current, then that those responsibilities moved over to our staff. For the property management, because we did need somebody on site to manage all of this, so we actually had an external contract through the Chancellor's Office, and that was for the first 5 years. At that point, the Chancellor's Office said, here you go, you're growing, let's go ahead and create an entity. So we did, called the University Blend Corporation. So UGC is what it was called. And it was self-managed, and it was an auxiliary of the university, but it was not state dollars. And then in 2017, of course, Kennedy Wilson came in and started managing our properties for us. Okay, so let's talk about what we think everybody would like, as opposed to what we've been doing. So we've got our slides up here. What we have heard from the community is we need defined roles and responsibilities. Who's responsible for what? What does this mean when we have a question about, you know, XYZ? A simplified reporting structure. Who reports to who? education, of course, we do need it from both communities. Our community has changed since 2002. Obviously, we have built out what we call phase one. And just recently, we're opening up and continue to open up Anacapa Canyon. And it's a very different type of model. So bringing representation from both sides. We do want to schedule meetings to encourage wider participation. We heard that in the last board meeting, the recommendation that at least one board meeting is at an evening like this, so that a wider variety of people can attend. And then also looking for that liaison to the site authority board. Right at the moment, that's done through the CAG, but we're looking at additional opportunity or maybe just changing it, the structure up to make it a little bit more user-friendly, for lack of a better word. So some of our thoughts are here. This is only, you'll notice that I have my little asterisk up to the far right of discussion, and that's because this is just part of our discussion. We really are looking for your input and feedback, and that's due to the self-governing nature. So some of the things that we talked about and that we are going to request through a survey with your feedback is looking at a coalition. Do we still call it a homeowners advisory group? Or do we consider, this is the time to kind of blow that up and say Anacapa Community Coalition, University Glen Community Coalition, having an identity that's very specific to what it is that you want to do and participate in. So I won't read all of these again. You will receive this, it'll be up on our webpage as well, but our next steps are to create a draft proposal once we've heard back from all of the community. We'll further define those roles and responsibilities. We do hope to present a refined option to the community and the site authority board by about May 1st. Our next board meeting is June 7th. Thank you. So that would be our target date for implementation. So we're about 6, 7, 8 weeks. We are not held to that date. It doesn't have to be June. But I just want you to understand that we are being aggressive because we really want to make sure that you have your input. And if you really want to see that change as soon as possible, then that's about the soonest that we can make it. Or we can move it to the next board meeting, which would be September. Okay. Continuing just a little bit on the restructure, this would be what we propose, but you might come back and say, no, that doesn't sound good. So again, just for your consideration, we would look at the University Glen Community Coalition to have three representatives from townhome owners or single family dwellings.
Sorry, I'm missing your picture.
We're working on it. Oh, I'm sorry.
No, go ahead. It's
okay.
Just connected again.
We'll okay. I don't know what's going on. And there's Paula. We actually have IT here. We actually have our professional staff, so I'm grateful. Yeah, thank you. Everybody good? Okay. So the University Glen Community Coalition, as I was mentioning, townhome or single family dwelling, three representatives for that. Mission Hills Apartment, one representative, and then the Town Center, Kennedy Wilson Properties, one. And then it would be a very similar situation for Anacapa Community Coalition. And what we're suggesting that we would like you to consider would be the subcommittees that are off to the right here. Finance, that would include budget, of course the architectural review, which is currently under the HHC, perhaps having a landscaping subcommittee or any other subcommittee that you would choose. So, and then we have suggested for meeting guidelines as well. And this is important just to understand. It could be subject to back and keen, which means that there would need to be appropriate notice given 10 days in advance, once or kept, things like that. Hold these meetings after hours to increase the community participation, posting minutes to the website. The subcommittees, that's the beauty. You could meet at your convenience, but no less than once per quarter. And then the coalition chairs would submit quarterly reports to the site authority board. So right now, the way that the board reports are done is we collect the information, we put it into a board report, and we provide it. This would be requesting that the two chairs of the two coalitions actually prepare those board reports for our elected.
Chancellor's office and myself.
Okay, so we're going to move into budget. I know that, you know, everyone's favorite subject, so this is just again a couple of highlights. Then we'll move into reserves, and then we'll start getting into Q&A. So, John?
Yeah, so I think a lot of people already know about the sort of budget cycle. How does it kick off, and when is it put into effect, and what is our fiscal year? But the slide tries to sort of walk us through that. So if you look at University of Glenn, Common Area Maintenance Manager, drafts the budget. We're targeting February 1 as an initial draft. And then that gets reviewed by the executive director, the budget advisory group. The budget advisory group, for those of you who might know, might not know, includes representatives from the homeowners and the apartments. And that occurs during this time. And you know, the nature of that draft budget is it's subject to change. That's the purpose of that period. And then site authority staff tries to start to, you know, sort of get close to a finalized budget, ideally around April, and then presents that budget to the HAC. And it's important to note the HAC really only includes homeowners, not the owners of the apartments, and they're, you know, roughly 60% of the doors within the University of Glenn community. And so the community advisory group, which also includes those apartment owners, is consulted. And then finally, the site authority board votes on the budget at their, in this instance, it'll be the June 7th meeting, but it's the end of the second quarter, and then that kicks off our fiscal year, which begins July 1. Next slide. There's really, at a very high level, two sort of parts of the budget. Fixed, meaning we do not have any control over them, and variable. And the fixed components are really the property management, although we are going out for a request for proposal, so that contract is under review. And then, you know, it's things like utilities and items that we just don't have any control over, that sort of thing. And then the areas that we do have some control over is if there was a desire to change the scope of landscaping services, if it was reducing frequency of service, that would be something that could impact the budget. Earthquake insurance, we buy most of our insurance through the CSU system, which provides advantageous pricing, but earthquake insurance is purchased on the open market, and so we go out for bids. We did very good last year. I'm hoping we do well again this year, so there's an opportunity to see some savings there. And then some other sort of variable expenses is there, you know, the amount of money that's contributed to townhouse reserves, you know, it's a trade-off. You know, if you don't save as much money now, you don't have as much money in your savings account, but that is something that can be discussed. And then reducing the levels of service, we talked about the landscaping, and then removing unnecessary expenses. Obviously, that's a subjective thing, but that would be things like, social committee, I know, is one that gets much discussion. So from there, talk about reserve contributions that I just mentioned.
Thanks. So thank you, Paula. As you're probably familiar, there are three reserve accounts. It's our common area maintenance, our single family, and then our townhomes. And off to the side of each of these, it kind of reminds you of what things are covered under there. Townhomes obviously have the majority of our expenses when it comes to reserves because there are shared rooms. There's a lot of common building pieces and components. And in the beginning, when this was initially, this community was created, there was a decision at that time to include a number of things such as furnaces and you know, the ducting within the actual home. So just a brief reminder of what's included in there. So let's talk about best practices with respect to reserve studies. We've done over the years a number of reserve studies. In fact, we'll have three slides on that. But just for those who, you know, don't live in the world of property management or, you know, this area, a level three is what we call a no-site visit. They are looking at it annually. They're using information that has been gathered in a level one visit, and that's done every 3 years. So measure of strength, and this comes, this is standard, in fact, this was from Complex Solutions with respect to the measure of strength. A community that has reserves somewhere between 31% and 69% is what they call a fair financial position. There is a majority of associations do fall into this category. And just as it says, you know, efforts should be taken to consider strengthening that financial position. So 70 to 99% funded, of course, is a strong financial position. So what's realistic? What we're shooting for is 70%. I believe, you know, the word out 100% funded has been bandied around, but it's never been a consideration. To be 100% funded would be a very strong, but probably unlikely, because reserves obviously are used for repairs over time, not your day-to-day repairs, but changing them when we have to change out rooms and different components, and it's put on a time schedule. So our goal is 70%. So on the next slide, and again, this presentation will be available, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time, because this first slide is common area. We are, our last review was at level 3 and found our common area reserves to be at 73%, so we're in a strong financial position. And so we're good there. If we go to the next slide, single family. Single family is actually at 84%, so extremely strong. This is because there's much less that is paid for out of the reserves with respect to single family homes. And then the one that I'm sure we're all interested in, the majority of the folks here are townhome owners, is our reserve spending for townhomes. So you can see as we go across 2019, 2020, there was such a study during the middle of COVID, and then we went to 2022, 2023. So you'll see that big jump from 57% in 2021 to 39% in 2022. And this was determined by the Complex Solutions, who did our reserve study, due to the cost to replace our tile roofs. And then there was also a 61% increase for those HVAC furnaces, and about an average of 9% in other components. So you think, wait, we've increased our dollar amount, so why did our percentage go down? Well, items, of course, as time goes on, we particularly saw through COVID price increases and or just an escalation, and that's what's reflected there. So to go to 23-24, we are currently at a 41% based on the level 3. So and some of these things, you know, were accelerated, such as garage door replacement, wrought iron fencing, you know, so just keep this in mind as we walk through a few more. The next, I don't anticipate anybody can read the slide. Please recognize the fact that, you know, it's all up there, and you're like, why would you even put it up there, Lori? Because I know that this presentation will be available for those who are at home. They can kind of blow it up on their screen. But this is basically options for funding. This is what was provided to us by our current vendor doing our reserve studies. And so take a look at this when you get a chance, but what I really want to point out is that lower green line. The green line basically represents the current annual reserve contributions and then the balance over time. So what you can see is that drop off in about 2034. So we look, you know, we're not bad until about that point, and then it just totally drops down. So that's why we're talking about the need to continue to contribute to the reserves to ensure that we do have the monies when the time comes to repair roofs, replace roofs, and all of those things that are in there. So let's go into a little bit of a history here. This is just a visual representation of the numbers basically that I noted in the other slide. So as you can see, as we go through, the reserves have been increasing. What you'll see in those red markers is where the 70% of ideal balance would be. So, you know, starting in 2021, you can see. So this is why we're having a lot of conversations about the reserves. All right, so I'm going to step back for just a moment because there's been some questions and I heard this narrative and I just really would like to take the opportunity to address people saying, well, I feel like site authority didn't put money in for the reserves, or they did such, or they did such. And so I want to share this. I know folks who have been following, I'm sorry?
Oh, no, you're right.
Thank you. Folks who have been following the board meetings and have seen this. So this isn't new information, but for those perhaps that this is your first time engaging with us, I wanted to just share this. So we did, there was a question back in 2020 about that reserves. Why are reserves not there? So we actually contacted a study, a comprehensive townhome reserves study was conducted, and we did a hypothetical and said, okay, if we had been collecting all the way back the appropriate reserves, where would we be running now? What is that delta from where we are now? And when I say if we've been, you know, going along, in 2006 and 2007, as we get to the campaigns, you'll see where we held, and we did not increase in it. There's multiple times we have not increased the camp fees, so consequently, reserves did not go up. So looking at this, we looked at the rentals that the university owned, we looked at the remaining 112 units, where those shortfalls were with respect to the camp fees, and then the total. And then the site authority made a decision to go ahead and contribute that amount into the reserves. Basically, as a good faith effort, we said, okay, even though we only charged this and there was a shortfall and, you know, owners should have been paying this much, we will do this and we will make them whole. And we got to the 70%, which was great. Of course, now you're like, now here we are again. Yeah. How did we get back here? So the summary, and we talked, and there, I'm just going to.
She said, did you say 2006?
No worries, it's just the owl will only pick up, so I'll invite you for it, so thanks. All right, so at that time, so you know, the reserves for the common area were at 73%, the single family 84%, strong position. So just really wanted to share that the site authority did. We made a contribution of just under $400,000 as a result of that analysis. So let's walk into our camp fees. Everybody can look at this. Go ahead, Paula, thank you. All right. So I'll give you a moment just to take a look. There's a lot of information on there. This is the history of our camp fees beginning in 2002. The red to the right is the reserve portion. So what you'll note is that starting out, our camp fee was $137.33, and that was in 2002. I know it sounds great, and it stayed there through 2005. It didn't change, so we never increased the camp fee for those 3 years, which is fine. But then there were increases the following 3 years, and then we went static again because of the Great Recession. So they stayed the same for 2008 and 2009. Then the increases from 2010 through 2015 were basically minimal or none. You'll see them pretty running, you see it's flat across there, okay? So homeowners had a pretty, you know, we were not increasing CAM fees at that time. Consequently, we were not increasing reserves either. Then we get to 2015 to 2016, and we actually decreased the CAM fee. And that was partly due to the fact that the community came forward and said, well, we've had Globus American. If you recall, if you've been here for a while, we used to have cars parked out on what we call 32 acres, where Gatacapa Canyon is now. And they were using that for vehicle storage, and it reflected about, what was it, $432,000, and then an additional $480,000 operations and rental. And then it was offset. So we made a contribution to bring the camp fees up. So we put it, the money's back in, okay? And then, as I noted, you know, the 2020, we did that. So this is, again, just an example of where we've been and where we've been going. Obviously, during the pandemic, we didn't raise any camp fees either. So how did we get to 24, 25? We'll go back at 2020 to 2021. We'll take a look, but I recall signing off on that one. So we'll just for that 1 year period. We'll go back. Our numbers are reflecting those numbers. And I'll just remind you, please, because of the way that the count and how it's set up, we'll allow the public comment after. So thank you. All right. So camp fee increases. So what causes them? Obviously, things cost money. These things happen throughout our world, our day. Gas is everything is going up in our world. I'm a homeowner. My utilities go up. My insurance goes up. Whatever it is. So these are the things that obviously can impact an increase of a CAM fee. So what are things that we could potentially do? You heard John mention that during the budget conversation. Looking at a cost differential for the management company contract, decreasing landscaping, scope of services, change from a shared expense to an individual expense. We'll talk a little bit about that in just a moment. And then remove components in the reserve. These are just actual costs that are part of the CAM fee. They're not negotiable per se. We need to have a management company, we need to have landscaping, but what we do within those are the things that we can have the conversations about. We just have to consider the fact that, if we're looking at, in particular, our reserves, it may end up in a special assessment at some point. We're 20 years down the road and all the roofs become a catastrophic or whatever. It's just time for all the roofs to be, and we don't have enough money in reserves. We have to replace roofs. So let's just look at the CAM fee comparison here for the townhomes. Again, you can read it down from 24-25. There was an under budget in 22-23, and that was due to insurance. There was an increase in our insurance rates due to California fires. But the reserve contribution, if we were to maintain that flat, this is just a drag. But the fact that at some point we would need a special assessment. But you can see where the increases are. Administratively, there's no change. Maintenance, little to no change. Utilities, landscaping, all the way down. Where we really see it, of course, is in insurance, our earthquake insurance, and we're still waiting for that quote. So what are some other considerations that we'd like to put out to you? And these are things that are going to take some time to think through. It potentially might require approval by the board. It might require changes within our ground sublease. But we are looking at utilities right now. Your utilities are basically all for one for all. If we were to install water meters on the townhomes, we could remove that out of your CAM fee, right? You as an individual then be responsible for your water pretty much like as most homeowners do, or you might find in a typical HOA, somebody would engage with Camrose Center, whoever their water provider is, and they'd pay that bill. And then you'd only be paying for what you use. There would need to be just a small administrative fee, but that's what I pay to my water company. And the site authority would bear the cost of that one-time installation. So what we're looking for on this, and we'll put out to you, is the community feedback. We would need to do, of course, the financial analysis impact, present that to the community and the board. If we talk about removing components in that townhouse reserve, we've talked about the furnace. This is an unusual one. None of us in this room, at least on the site authority side, were here in 2002 when the decision was made to include furnaces in your homeowner fee. So that does constitute about 17.5% of all of our total components. It's a big number. You can read through the numbers. And so this is something that what we would want to do is, again, we need to talk to the community, poll the community, to determine somebody and they call a contractor and they come out and replace it versus their homeowners association coming in and replacing that for them. So this is something to be considered. You know, other components that could be considered that are included, again, typically not in a situation where you have a shared, would include garage doors and sliding doors. However, that financial impact isn't nearly as significant as the furnaces themselves. So, as John mentioned, we currently do have what's called a RFP, a request for proposal, out. This is just good business. We go out, we ask for competitive bids, and in this case, this is the management, the property management contract that is in process. We have two members of the community who are serving on that committee, along with John Lazarus and representation from ENS Ring and Kennedy Wilson. So three bids were received, and so this is just walking through basically what the process is. We are looking that somewhere around mid-April, which we're getting pretty close to, the contract will be awarded, and then that will start July 1st. So what does that mean? That means that will potentially change a number. I don't know which direction, I don't know how much or how little, I am not privy to that, but that will be part of the budget process as we move forward for the July 1 date. The landscaping contract was completed in 2022. We did go out for bid. It was awarded to Govt Landscaping. We can go out to bid prior to the end of the contract at any time. We're also able to renegotiate terms prior to the expiration. So, you know, that's always good to just keep in mind if we want to talk about things that we are looking to do. So I feel like I have done a lot of talking, which I'm sure you're agreeing with me. And so really our next steps are, we're just going to put up some slides as to far as what we received, some of our responses, and then we're going to collect any, you know, cards that you have if you'd like to submit your question that way. Or if you'd like to submit your question in, you know, in a public, you're welcome to. I would just ask if you can just kind of come somewhere around here so that the microphone and the camera can you know, record, and those folks who are joining us online would be able to hear the question. So let's go ahead and start. Thank you, Paula. So we can go through every question. What I suggest is, you know, take a look through there. You know, we've gotten questions about budget. So what we tried to do was kind of combine budget, operations, the ground subsidies, special tax. So, you know, Anacapa is completely different, two totally separate. And then the question was asked about the insurance carriers. We can go out and negotiate for earthquake insurance because that is not done through the Chancellor's office. The benefit of the insurance that we currently have through the CO is that you get economies of scale, of course. We have 23 campuses, we have a lot of entities, and we're able to purchase insurance as a very, very large organization as opposed to a mid-sized community. So, you know, the explanation over the 300%, great question. One is, yes, water usage has risen. Apartments are now being charged based on metered consumption instead of per door. So if you go back, before it was all for one and one for all. So